Hi everyone, today I'm going to talk about the solution algorithms for pressure-velocity coupling in Navier-Stokes equations. The focus of today's video is on the staggered and collocated grid arrangements. Every fluid flow must satisfy the equations of momentum and continuity. The general form of the transport equation represents the law of conservation. For each optional control volume, the integral form of the transport equation is written as follows, like this equation. In this equation, F indicates the face of the control volume surface and N is the direction perpendicular to the surface of control volume. In momentum equations, velocity is substituted with phi and viscosity with gamma, and surface and volumetric forces are expressed in the source term, which is shown on the right hand side of the transport equation for the variable phi as this term. If velocity is to be substituted with phi, there are a few things to keep in mind. First, the flux expression convection term, as shown here, has nonlinear quantities like this, right? Which are the multiplication of the velocity components. The equations of momentum and continuity are coupled, because each component of velocity appears in all equations. And the third point is that the pressure appears in the source expression in momentum equations. This makes the equations more interdependent. To continue the discussion, we write the equations of continuity and momentum in their differential form as follows. As can be seen, there are four equations and five unknowns, which includes three components of velocity, right, u, v, and w, and pressure together with density, which is rho, and it's shown here, rho. The fifth equation is the equation of a state. Therefore, density is obtained by the equation of continuity, velocity by the equations of momentum, and pressure by the equation of a state. The above set of equations are used for compressible flows at high speeds. In other words, in compressible flows, the continuity equation is a transport equation for density that together with the internal energy equation determines the pressure by the thermodynamic relationship of the law of ideal gases. Here, attention is given to the solution of incompressible flows, and there will be no discussion about the calculation of compressible flows. In compressible flows, the continuity equation is written as follows. In this case, the density changes are due mainly to temperature, not pressure. Therefore, in the incompressible flows, there are four equations and four unknowns. The important issue here is a lack of an equation for pressure. In incompressible flows, due to the unrelatedness of the density changes to the pressure, a pressure equation is obtained as a constraint on solving the equations of momentum to satisfy the continuity equation. This pressure equation is obtained indirectly through the continuity equation. Now let's talk about the pressure-velocity coupling. In this section, we will answer an important question, which is whether pressure and velocity values should be stored in the same nodes or not. Here, we first discretize the momentum equation over a one-dimensional control volume as shown here. Here, we have three nodes, right? P, W, western point, and the eastern point, E. And here we are showing the control volume surfaces also, which are shown by lower letters W and E, eastern side, western side. We now take the integral from the pressure gradient on this control volume to discretize it like this. Now write the discretized form of the momentum equation in the x direction in the following order. The last term on the right hand side shows the source term, right? From this relation we can understand how the relationship between the velocity and pressure is in the discretized equation. As can be seen, velocity is related to the pressure gradient by the pressure difference between the two sides of the node. By putting the above relation in the continuity equation, an equation for pressure can be obtained. Okay? Since the pressure values are stored in the nodes, the next step is to obtain the values of the pressures, right, at the surfaces at the eastern and western surfaces, which are shown here, right, on the control volume surfaces in terms of the pressure values in the nodes. Okay, so we can use linear interpolation to obtain the values of the pressures at the control volume surfaces, right, in terms of the node values as follows. This means that nodes are used one by one to calculate the pressure gradient. In other words, we skip the cell value of pressure at node P. Right here, we don't see any value of the pressure at this node. This reduces accuracy, okay? In the presence of oscillating changes in pressure, incorrect information can be propagated in the computational field. The same can also be seen by integrating the expression of the velocity gradient in the continuity equation. Considering a linear profile for velocity, we will have an equation like this. As can be seen in this equation, the value of velocity at the node P here is not present here in this equation. Now using this equation here together with this figure, the continuity equation is written as follows. Thus, the continuity equation produces an equation for pressure, but as can be seen, the pressure values at nodes E and W do not appear in this equation, right? There is no such pressure. The pressure at the nodes E and W are absent here. Thus, the continuity equation produces an equation for pressure, but as can be seen, the pressure values at nodes E and W do not appear in this equation, which is not correct physically, right? In short, in fact, the combination of the pressure and velocity values being stored in the same nodes and the linear interpolation that we use to calculate velocities on the control volume surfaces cuts the values of pressure of pressures in odd nodes from the values of pressures in even nodes. Okay, this causes fluctuations in the pressure field and consequently in the velocity field. Okay, to solve this problem there are two solutions. First is using a staggered grid for velocity. In other words, velocity and pressure are stored in different nodes And the second one is using a collocated grid, where the velocity and pressure values are stored in the same nodes. However, we're going to use a different interpolation technique, which is the Rai and Chow interpolation. Let's first talk about the staggered grid. One remedy to eliminate non-physical fluctuations in the velocity and pressure fields is using a staggered grid. In this figure, the staggered grid is shown here. This figure shows a two-dimensional staggered grid. In this form, it is easy to distinguish the main control volume from the displaced or the staggered control volume. The pressure is stored in the center of the main control volume, and the velocity components are stored in the center of the displaced control volumes, which are in fact the surfaces of the main control volume. Additionally, scalar quantities such as enthalpy, temperature, and all flow properties such as density and transport coefficients are stored in the center of the main control volume. However, what are some advantages of using this staggered grid? The discretized form of the continuity equation in the main control volume is as follows. One advantage of the staggered grid method is that there is no need for interpolation to calculate the velocity components on the control volume surfaces, because the velocity components in the staggered grid are calculated and stored on the control volume surfaces. Therefore, the possibility of oscillations in the velocity field is eliminated. Another important point is that the pressure gradient between two nodes indicates the velocity between the two nodes, as shown here. Further, the velocity components are also stored at points that are necessary to ensure the mass conservation. Here, in fact, the velocity, the U, uppercase P, in the staggered grid is the same as the U, lowercase w, okay, in the unstaggered grid. In the unstaggered grid, we had to perform a linear interpolation to calculate this velocity component. However, this was exactly what causes the problem, right? And here interpolation is no longer needed because the velocity is calculated where it is required. For example, according to this figure, okay, in the x direction, we have equation like this. Note that the effect of the pressure at the node P is not removed here. The pressure equation also has the same standard form as other scalar transport equations. Therefore, one and the same solver can be used to solve all the transport equations. However, using this method, the staggered grid arrangement has its own disadvantages, such as, for instance, one important disadvantage of using this type of grid is its geometric complexity, because in this grid, different nodes and grids must be used to calculate and store different physical quantities, right? The volume of storage of geometric information of nodes and grids, as well as their calculation in each iteration, makes it difficult to write a code, and also will slow down the calculation process. Additionally, using this grid becomes even more complicated in cases of advanced modeling in turbulence. Other shortcoming of the use of the staggered grid emerges in the use of the arbitrary grids. In these cases, as shown in this figure, there is a possibility that the velocity nodes will not be placed between the pressure nodes, which makes it difficult to use the above mentioned relations, right? To solve all these problems and reduce the volume of storage of information, it is suggested to use a collocated grid arrangement to to store velocity and pressure values in the center of the control volumes in the same nodes. In the collocated grid, the interpolation method to calculate the velocities on the surfaces of control volumes is changed, and the Rye and Chow interpolation technique is used instead. Here, the collocated grid arrangement is shown. As can be seen, all the velocity components and the pressure are stored at the same nodes. Okay. In 1983, Rye and Chow proposed the use of a collocated grid arrangement to calculate velocity components. To describe the proposed method, consider the eastern surface of a control volume as shown in this figure. So let's consider here. We are going to calculate the velocity at this surface. The discretized form of the momentum equation in one dimension is shown here. This equation can be rewritten as this one, right? As this equation. Now, by subtracting the pressure gradient from the velocity field, we obtain a new velocity field. In fact, we subtract the pressure gradient in each control volume from the velocity stored in the center of the same control volume. Okay, as shown here, we are subtracting the pressure gradients from the velocity values at nodes P and E, and then here we are discretizing this pressure gradient. Now, by using a linear interpolation, the velocity is obtained at the control volume surface E as follows, right? At this one, we use a linear interpolation. The pressure gradient is now added to calculate the velocity over the control volume surface, okay? The important point here is that we don't obtain the pressure gradient by interpolation, but we calculate it at the control volume surface. Okay, so in order to obtain the original velocity at this surface, at this control volume surface, we add this pressure gradient, okay, to the value of the velocity, right, to this velocity which is obtained through this equation. Now we discretize, right, the pressure gradient. This method of calculating velocity on control volume surfaces is called Rye and Chow interpolation technique. All the velocity components on the control volume surfaces are calculated with this type of interpolation. These velocity components are used to calculate the diffusion and convection values on control volume surfaces. Okay? So now, substituting these equations here, right, these equations here, into this equation, we're going to have the value of the velocity at the eastern surface like this. It is observed that, in fact, using the Rye and Chow interpolation technique is like adding a pressure diffusion term, which is proportional to a third order pressure gradient, right? The purpose of this phrase is to eliminate pressure fluctuations and consequently velocity fluctuations. In the continuity equation, this expression is proportional to a fourth order pressure gradient, which is shown here. How this expression appears can be shown by substituting the velocity values, okay, calculated using the same interpolation technique in the continuity equation. Okay, this is the end of this video. I hope you found this video useful. Please let me know what you think about this video by leaving a comment in the comment section. Thank you for watching the video, and for further upcoming videos, please subscribe to this channel.